everybody. Once again, thank you all for coming out. This is the collection of the brightest, best-looking people in town, in all of Brevard County. Tonight it is my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Hakeem Oluseyi. He's an assistant professor here. Got his Ph.D. in Stanford. He has been here since about 2007. Most recently, you may have seen him on the Discovery Channel. He was on one of the Curiosity episodes. Recently, he's been very involved in founding the African Astronomical Society, and in fact is the founding president of the organization. Tonight, he's going to talk to you about the creation.
That's right.
So, looking forward to it.
Thanks. All right. I was actually standing next to him because the mic is on me, so that's why I was over there. Thank you guys for coming out tonight. I know tonight there's a lot of, this is not a Halloween party, Halloween party's happening. So instead of going to that, you came here to hear this. So why the creation? I love talking about this topic. And one reason is because I think that scientists have done a very poor job of explaining to people how we know what it is that we know, okay? And how we actually do science. So I think that the story of how we have come to understand how the universe formed and it has evolved is one of the best stories in the history of science. And so I love telling the story, if nothing else, but I think it also really illustrates how science is done. And so there are some poorly understood concepts about how science is done that I like to cover first. And so one of them, for example, is relationship between theory and prediction, right? You often hear people criticize in the media what is very sound science. And I think the reason is because they don't quite understand how science is done. So there's one story from the history of science that I'd like to relate to you all. And that's the story of Poisson's spot. Do you guys know that story? No? Okay, so it took place in the 19th century. The French Academy had a contest, an essay contest, and the topic was explain the phenomenon of diffraction. Right? So when we look at how light behaves, there were three major problems with how it travels. One was the problem of reflection, right, which Hero of Alexandria solved in about 60 BCE. Then there was the problem of refraction, which we call Snell's Law, but that was actually first discovered empirically by a guy named Ibn al-Haytham around the turn of the century between around the year 1000 or so. And then there was this problem of diffraction, whereas if you look at how when light travels around things, you see these little bands of light. And that was poorly understood. So they held this essay contest, and a scientist named Fresnel submitted a very eloquent essay, and it, I guess elegant is the better word, and his essay relied on the fact that light was a wave. Okay, and one of the scientists on the committee that evaluated the essays, all of the other committee members felt that Fresnel's essay was the best, but this one scientist, Poisson, who's a very capable mathematician who established many of the foundations of physics, Poisson did not believe this idea that light traveled as a wave. Poisson thought, as Isaac Newton thought, that light traveled as a system of particles. So what he did is he looked at the theory, right? And that's a key word here. What do we mean by theory? Quite often, when lay people use the word theory, what they mean is a hypothesis, right? An idea, a guess. But when we scientists use the word theory, what the theory is, it's the mathematical foundations. It's the mathematical expression of the scientific phenomenon, and that is what allows you to make predictions of stuff that has never been seen or never been observed before. So Poisson did what any good theorist would do. He took Fresnel's equations, and because he disliked Fresnel's ideas, he explored those equations to see if he could find something ridiculous that they predicted, right? And so if a theory predicts something that you know is not true, then you know that the theory is incorrect. And so Poisson found something. He found something that was obviously ridiculous. And what is that? He found that if you have a sphere and you take it into a dark room and you shine a light on the sphere, then Fresnel's equations predicted that in the center of the shadow of the sphere, there should be a point of light. Now that's obviously ridiculous, right? In the center of the shadow is where the shadow should be darkest. But yet Fresnel's theory predicted that it should be a spot of light there. So Poisson, he presented this to the committee, and one of the gentlemen on the committee was an experimentalist named Arago, and he said, wow, you know, what Poisson said is pretty convincing, but you know, I don't know if anyone has ever done the experiment. So I'm gonna take a sphere into a dark room, and I'm going to shine a light on it and see what I get. And guess what? It was there, right? The spot of light was there. And that's the key point. One key point about physics is prediction, right? You write down theories that make predictions. So if Isaac Newton writes down force equals mass times acceleration, it predicts what the trajectory of a particle would be, say for instance, if I threw a golf ball. I could calculate what F equals MA tells me should happen, compare that to what actually happens, and if they don't match up, clearly you're wrong, right? And so theory is a big part. You have to write down this set of equations, and prediction is a big part. Plays a big role. Another thing that's poorly understood is the interactions of light and matter. Everyone is familiar with light. It's all around us, right? And we know, I ask my students the question, where does light come from? Who has an answer? Where does light come from? Yes, sir. Yes, that's a great answer. I get a lot of answers. Stars, fireflies, right? But the simple answer is that matter makes it. Right? Matter makes light. That's where light comes from. And so I ask my students, whenever you see light being emitted from somewhere, ask yourself, what exactly is the matter doing to create that light? If you see a flame, what is it in that flame that is generating the light that you see? What's the difference between a gas flame and a blue flame? Why does one look bluer, one look redder? What's the difference between an incandescent light bulb and a fluorescent light bulb? What is the sun doing? Okay? And so people see this happening all around us, but this is how we understand the universe. This is how we study the universe, right? We look at a star, and it's just a spot of light. I mean, it's just a tiny dot, right? And you ask an astronomer, tell me something about that star. The astronomer can say, well, it's this far away. It has this chemical composition. It's moving in this particular fashion. It's this age sometimes. It has this mass, right? How do you get all of this information out of a dot of light, right? And so that's important to understand, and we'll talk about that in a second. Another thing that happens a lot, I go around the world, I give these talks, and whenever I talk about cosmology or the Big Bang, you know, this is an idea that impacts philosophy, it impacts theology, it's something that everybody's interested in, right? Our own origins. And so it's a hot topic for debate, right? And so I'll give the talk, and afterwards someone always comes up to me and they'll say, well, you said that science says, but something else says something different, right? And I've always been bothered by the phrase science says, because as I understand science, science doesn't say anything, right? Science listens, right? We listen to the universe and we read what it tells us, right? It's also a method, right, that we use to understand what it's saying, but then we report back what the universe has told us, right? We don't say anything as scientists. We just report what we've observed, right? Let me do some science. There's a drink on your table, right? I've observed the drink there. That's science, you know? And so this misunderstanding of what science does and how scientists behave, the culture of science, is also a poorly understood phenomenon. For example, people say that they don't believe in this result of science, or they don't believe in that result of science, right? Without really having an understanding of how scientists behave. So if you guys ever watched this sitcom called The Big Bang Theory? Yeah? Yeah? Now imagine, so there's Sheldon, who's the other guy that he's always making? Leonard, yeah. Suppose Leonard says something that's slightly wrong. How does Sheldon respond? Yeah, exactly, right? So I get the feeling sometimes that people who aren't scientists think that every 20, 30 years or so, all the world's scientists gather in a room, and we have the same topic every time. What is the lie we're all gonna agree on, right? And so at one time, it was the Big Bang. Recently, it's the climate change, right? At one point, it was the results of geology, okay? But if you understand scientists and how they behave, right? When Dan comes up with something, Dan Bachador here, my colleague in the department, if he comes up with some, you know, great idea, you know, I'm gonna say to his face, Dan, great job, man. But inside, I'm going to be thinking, I hate you, right? It reminds me of I heard this comedian, she had lived in London. She was American. She lived in London, and she moved back to the U.S., and she was talking about the differences in the cultures. And she said that in America, you know, if your neighbor gets this bright, shiny new car, you know, you want one, too. You know, you want a bright, shiny new car, too. But in London, they're not like that. If your neighbor gets a bright, shiny new car, they don't want one, too. They want you to die in a fiery crash in your bright, shiny new car, right? So that's how scientists are, okay? So when we study this idea of the origin of the universe, the creation of the universe, we have to start with certain questions, right? And then there are certain science that we need to even address the question. So I'm going to give you a quick little overview of those topics. So the first question that we ask is, okay, if I'm going to have to account for what exists, that's a good question to start with. What exists, right? And what is it doing? And where is it? You know, and, you know, that's get some understanding. And so once we have that those answers, which we'll do in the next slide, there are some other things that are going to look a little bit intimidating. But, you know, when it comes to communicating science to the public, I take the George Clinton approach. You guys know George Clinton? Parliament Funkadelic? Yeah, yeah, he had that song, Make My Funk the P-Funk. I like my funk uncut, right? And so that's how I like to deliver science. So I'm going to use the words, and I'm going to show you, throw up some equations, right? Which, you know, they say you should never do when you're talking to the public, but that's how I'm going to do it. You know, I can remember back when I was a new graduate student, and whenever I attended a talk, I never understood anything ever, right? And no one dumbed anything down for me, right? They kept using the language, and eventually I got to a day when I understood everything, right? No matter, even if I had never heard of it before, I could understand it. So I'm gonna give it to you like it is. So the first foundation is general relativity and Einstein's field equations, right? And essentially what this tells us is how, when we look at the evolution of the universe, the physical force that dominates everything is gravity. Right? And this is what this tells us is, how do particles, or how does matter and everything else that moves through space and time, how does it react to a gravitational field? And also, how do these things generate gravitational fields? Then there is the cosmological metric. When cosmologists think about the volume that we call the universe, we don't think of it as a volume. We think of it as a surface, a hypersurface, we call it, a three-dimensional hypersurface. And so whenever you study surfaces, I see a couple of my students in here, you always have to define, how do you measure intervals on this surface? How do you measure distances on the surface? So if you're on the surface of a sphere, you measure distances in a different way than if you're on the surface of a flat plane, for example. So in our space-time, how do we measure these distances? I'm not going to talk too much about that. But also, if you're going to study the universe, right, if you're doing science, you have to make predictions, which means you have to have a theory. Right? You have to have some equations that describe the phenomenon under study against which you can compare. And those equations for cosmology are known as the Friedman equations. And also, when we look at the concept of distance, it makes sense in our everyday lives, but when you look at it on the cosmic scales, it's not quite as straightforward. For example, the universe is expanding, right? How do you take that into account when you measure distances? When we measure distances, quite often what we do is we compare something we know to the way something appears. For example, if I have a rod and I know how long it is, if I look at it at different distances, it will appear to have different lengths, right? The more distant it is, the smaller it will appear. The same thing goes with the brightnesses of objects, right? If I have an object of a known brightness, if I place it at different distances, its brightness would appear different based on its distance from me, right? And as it turns out in cosmology, you will actually get different answers. If you have two things that are the same distance away from you, and you use the rod method in one case, and you use the brightness method in the other case, the method of standard candles and standard rods, you'd get different answers if you didn't take into account the effect of the expanding universe, right? You have to take these things into account. So, and then there's the real answer we want, which is, you know, how far is it really away from me, right? And also another way of doing it is you can ask, how long does it take light to reach me, right? So there's four different ways that we define distances cosmically. And all of it has to be taken into account. Okay, so what exists? So obviously matter and energy, right? We're made of matter, it's around. We got a lot of energy in this room, Yeah, got a lot of energy. And you know, Einstein taught us that energy and matter are related through E equals MC squared. There is space and time, right? You know, what space? That which separates here from there. At least it was until we discovered quantum entanglement, but that's another talk. What is time? You know, that which prevents all things from happening at the same moment, or something like that. Then there are light and fields, right? We know that fields exist, right? And light is a traveling, oscillating electromagnetic field. But you know, you can take a magnet, a bar magnet, and sprinkle iron filings on it on a piece of paper, right? You can actually visualize the field. For students that are in our senior lab, we actually have an apparatus where they go in and they actually measure the field, right? It's direction and its strength at different locations within this apparatus, right? So a field is a real thing. And so we have to come up with an idea of how all of these things come into existence. So let's start with, you know, what is the stuff doing? Where is it? This sort of question, right? So we look at the matter that's in the universe. The most obvious matter organizes itself in the galaxies. All right, our sun is in a galaxy like this. This is an artist's conception of the Milky Way galaxy. It's a barred spiral. We're in no special location. Our galaxy contains roughly 100 billion stars. Whereas we once thought that we were at the center of the universe and the entire galaxy, that we were very special. When you're one of 100 billion, right, you could reach in there and grab a handful of stars and throw it away, right? And no one would notice, right? So that's how special being a star in a galaxy is. And as you go out away from our galaxy, we're in a system of galaxies, right? The Milky Way has small galaxies that orbit it. There's around 26 or so that have been discovered so far, though theories predict there should be around 200 and some odd galaxies. As we move farther away, we see that our galaxy is one in a group of galaxies known as a local group, with Andromeda being the closest. Let me give you an idea. Let me get your mind around something here. This Andromeda galaxy is 2 million light years away. Okay, so it takes like 2 million years to reach us. So you know how objects look smaller the more distant they are? Yeah? The size actually falls off. The angular size actually falls off with the square of the distance. If it's twice as far away, it looks 1/4 as big, right? 3 times farther away, 1/9 as big, so forth and so on. So this guy is 2 million light years away. Guess how big it appears in our sky, say compared to the full moon. What would your guess be? It's actually 6 times bigger. It subtends 3 degrees of arc in the sky, right? That thing is huge. Yeah, that's pretty big, right? And it's headed right at us. So talk about property values dropping. And so our galaxy is part of the local group as a cluster, and there are many other clusters around us. And we're at the edge of the Virgo supercluster. So the clusters cluster to form superclusters. And as it turns out, we're right on, if you look at the distribution of mass, you see that there's regions where there's lots of galaxies. We call those regions filaments. And regions where there are very few galaxies, we call those regions voids. And I don't know if it's good news or bad news, but the universe is avoiding us. If you look at where our star is, the sun, it's in what we call the local bubble. Right? So there's, you know, the density of matter and stars where we are is much less than the average. And our galaxy is actually on the edge of a void, right? The so-called Thule void, named after the guy who discovered it. So for some reason, all the matter is avoiding us. And so as we go out on larger scales, we're at the scale of 100 million light years here. These filament void regions are about 150 million light years across on average. And so once we go out to very large scales, we see that the universe is pretty much evenly distributed. It's kind of like being in a carpet, looking at a shag rug, right? If you're a flea or an ant and you're walking through a shag rug, it doesn't look uniform, right? There's a big giant carpet fiber tree in front of you. Then there's this big wide open space, right? Then there's another, right? But if you're standing far away, you look at the carpet, it looks pretty smooth. Right? It's like looking at a hillside, you know, of trees or something. It looks really smooth from a distance. And so as you get far enough away, on large enough scales, the universe is uniform. And this is how cosmologists think of the universe when they study it. You basically imagine that you have space-time and it's filled with a uniform gas. Okay? And it's because of that that we can actually write down the theory of the universe, these equations of motion. You have to have this assumption in order to write it down. And so this slide, I meant to take that out. So now let's talk about light, the interaction of matter and light. Okay, so see, that's an equation. Anybody scared? I didn't think so. See, it's okay. So what this equation says is this is a so-called black body spectrum. Why black body? Well, if you look at the textbook definition of a black body, what's said is a black body is a body that absorbs all the light incident upon it. What does that mean? Kind of hard to understand. It's a fancy way of saying that it does not reflect any light. Okay, so you're looking at me via reflected light. Light is striking me, right, and bouncing back to your eyes. You receive it. That's how you're looking at me. But if you had an instrument that could record all the light coming from me, you see that there were two sources of light. One source is the light that is bouncing off of me, and the other source is the light that I am emitting, right? And so the part that I am emitting is the so-called black body radiation, right? So if I was not reflecting any light, all you'd see is the light that I emit. And so any opaque object emits this black body radiation. And only opaque objects emit black body radiation. Okay? That's a key point. So the key point here is that every time, whatever state matter is in, it has a unique signature. And this black body curve is the unique signature of opaque bodies. And where the peak occurs tells you the temperature of the body. So something as cool as me, we emit in the infrared, right? That's why the military uses infrared goggles. If you were to heat me up, I'd die. But if you were to heat up a bar of iron, right, it's black, it's emitting infrared light. Then it starts to emit red light. I mean, red light, right? It turns red hot. Then if you heat it up more, if you talk to a machinist, they call it straw hot or something like that, straw yellow. Anybody a machinist in the room? Yeah, is that it, straw? Oh, never mind. So, we got any physicists? No. But the point is that the wavelength of the radiation that is emitted depends on the temperature of the object. Okay, and a precise formula relates the energy of the light. This HF here is the energy of the light, and that KT, that T is the temperature of the body. Right. So the light at a given frequency depends on the temperature of the body. So here, for example, is the red line is the light that is emitted by the sun. And the blue line is the best fit black body curve. All right, you see it fits pretty nicely. And if you take that same formula that I gave you over there, you put in that temperature, you get that blue curve right there. Okay, but you see that it's somewhat different, right? They don't fit exactly. Some places the red one is higher, some places the blue one is higher, and then the red one has all these little squiggly lines on it, right? And so if we zero in, we see that there's another process that's going on. And what's happening here is that cool gas over the surface of the sun is absorbing some of this light, creating these absorption lines. And these absorption lines, where they occur, depends on the structure of the individual atoms. And all the atoms, one atom is not the same as another atom. So each atom has a unique set of spectral lines. So I can look at these lines, and that tells me what's going on in the gas. So the point I'm making here is that we can interpret the light and get a unique answer from just looking at the light that's emitted by the object or the light that's absorbed by the object or something like that, right? So now we have to talk about the hard stuff. Okay, this is the theoretical foundation. This is the theory that's going to allow us to make predictions about the universe. So the first thing is the Einstein field equations. And it looks complex, but it's really simple. What it says is this T right here, the stress energy tensor, is the stress energy tensor. Is that what I said? Yes, that's what I meant to say. It is the stuff that's in a volume of space-time. And G here is how space-time reacts, right? The so-called shape of the space-time. So what Albert Einstein showed us is that a presence of matter or energy density in space-time effectively curves space-time, and the shape of space-time then determines how stuff moves, okay? Now, this introduces a new concept. And that is the idea that space-time itself is dynamic, okay? Previous to this, when people studied physics, they studied matter and its motion through space-time, right? And how it behaves in space-time. So space and time were sort of like a background grid that was passive. But now space becomes dynamic. Space responds to the presence of matter, and it interacts with matter and energy to determine how it moves. Here are the so-called Friedman equations, right? The Einstein-Friedman equation is the top one, and that equation is simply conservation of energy for the universe. And the one below it is the equation of motion, force equals mass times acceleration, effectively, right? Like Newton's second law, okay? And so they look complex, but let me break it down a little bit. The first one is the one that's really relevant. They're both relevant, but the first one basically says that the expansion velocity of the universe is proportional to the density of the universe minus its curvature, right? So why is curvature in there? Well, we saw that Albert Einstein told us that matter is going to react to the shape of space-time, okay? And so the curvature of the universe is an important quantity here. So we speak of the curvature of the universe as being positive, negative, or zero curvature, okay? And so if space is negatively curved, it expands. If space is positively curved, it tends to contract, and if it's flat, it sort of expands, but not, if that makes sense, right? And so what happens is that as time moves forward, the density gets smaller. The curvature doesn't change so much, right? The curvature is a global property of the universe. It does change over long cosmological times, but not so much so. We assume it's relatively constant for most times, right? The acceleration of the universe depends on the density of the universe minus a term proportional to the pressure, right? And so what can happen with this is that the pressure can actually be negative. And so if the pressure becomes negative, then acceleration, which is negative typically because gravity is attractive, can become repulsive, right? And that gives us what we call our dark energy in the universe. And so the curvature of the universe determines the fate of the universe. So if I go back to this equation here, right, and I ask myself, under what conditions is k equal zero? What that means is, let me just get rid of this term here, right? If I set k to zero, this term doesn't exist. Then I can solve for this density, and that tells me the density of space-time that would give me a zero curvature universe. So what do I mean by that? Remember, we think of the universe as this fog, and the universe reacts the matter energy in the universe is a fog, and space-time reacts, its curvature reacts to the density of the mass and energy. So you can think of it like this. Imagine if negative curvature looks like a hill. And I use a hill because, you know, space expands when it's negatively curved, and things flow down a hill. Now let me place some mass energy density on the hill. It tends to flatten it, right? And if I put just the perfect amount, it'll be perfectly flat. And if I add more, it begins to get the opposite curvature, and now things flow together, right? So if you solve this equation for k equals zero to get the no curvature universe, then you get this expression right here. And all we've done is we've replaced this a dot over a with h, right? You get this expression for the critical density. That's the density that will yield a zero curvature space-time, okay? And so if we compare the actual density of the universe to this critical density, then that ratio tells us the fate of the universe. For example, suppose k is a positive number, all right? Then what will happen is that because the first term changes with the size of the universe, the density, right? Suppose the density is originally bigger and the curvature is some number. If k is positive, it's always a minus sign there, right? And so as the universe gets bigger and the density falls off, because density is mass per unit volume, right? As the volume gets bigger, the first term gets smaller with time. Eventually, they will become equal. And then the density will be smaller. So that means that the universe will expand, and then it'll stop expanding when they're equal, and then it'll start to contract again. If k is negative, then the minus sign there times the minus k gives you a plus. And in that case, the universe expands forever. So if the universe has a negative curvature, that term on the right-hand side is positive definite. Are you guys still with me? Yeah. All right, so those are our three cases, right? We can have a flat space where the universe expands forever, but it expands ever more slowly, so it seems like it's not expanding anymore. Or you can have a case where k is greater than 1, you have positive curvature, it expands and then collapses back, or you can have negative curvature there. So that's the importance of geometry in the evolution of the universe. So Albert Einstein looked at those equations and he saw that they predicted that the universe should evolve with time. He didn't believe this, so he introduced a term that would keep the universe static, right? Under those equations, everything in the universe, as far as he knew, was made of mass that had positive gravity that attracted things. And so under these equations, the universe would collapse. And that wasn't true, according to Albert Einstein. So he created this term that would add repulsive gravity to hold the universe up, right? And later, what happened is Edwin Hubble discovers that, in fact, the universe is dynamic. The universe is expanding. And what he did is he looked at galaxies, and he saw that if they were ever more distant, then they appeared to be moving away from us ever more quickly. So let me give you a more down-to-earth analogy, my world-famous rubber band analogy. So suppose I have a rubber band, and it's 1 meter long. And in 1 second, I stretch it so it's 2 meters long, right? And suppose I'm on this end of the rubber band. How fast does the opposite end, how fast do I measure it's moving away from me? Well, it was 1 meter away. A second later, it was 2 meters away, right? So I measured its motion to be 1 meter per second. Now suppose I look at a point halfway on the rubber band. It's half a meter away. A second later, it's still the center of the rubber band, but it's now 1 meter away. So it moved half a meter in that second, right? And the little piece right here next to where I'm holding it, it doesn't really even move at all, does it? Yeah, so those things that are farther away appear to move away faster, and the speed at which they're moving away is proportional to their distance from me, right? And that's what he found, right? Things more distant are moving away more quickly. All right, and so that led to our interpretation of this data is that the universe is expanding, okay? Edwin Hubble didn't accept that particular interpretation, ironically, but that was, that is the current interpretation, and now there's a lot of other evidence that leads to us to have a very strong understanding that that is actually what's going on. And so now there are some other consequences. If we look at individual galaxies, this is supposed to represent a region of space-time, okay? If we look at these three individual galaxies, they're at the vertices of these lines, okay? At some times later, they're still at the vertices of the lines. So the motion of galaxies through space-time, we call that the peculiar motion of galaxies. And it's very small, all right? And what happens, though, is that the distances between the vertices gets bigger with time. So although the galaxies haven't moved very much, the so-called Hubble flow has carried them away from each other. And the squiggly line represents light, right? Light is what we use to interpret the universe. And what happens is that as the light travels through intergalactic space, the wavelength of the light gets stretched by the exact same amount that space-time expanded as the light was traveling through it. So what does that mean? If a photon is emitted at some location in the universe and it travels through space, when it's observed by someone, if that photon has twice the wavelength it had when it left its source, that means that the universe now is twice as big as it was when it left that source. All right? So measuring light from distant objects allows us to directly measure the size of the universe versus time. And that's what a Hubble diagram is. That's, in fact, what Hubble was measuring. So now, because of this, we now have a foundation to do our cosmology, all right? And the first person to do this was a gentleman named Gamow. So there were some very peculiar observations that had been made that people could not explain. Hubble had given us a scenario in which to solve those problems. So what were they? Well, one thing that happened is that as we took our telescopes and took spectra of gases and stars all around the universe, we found that things were made up of pretty much the same stuff everywhere. Okay? So everywhere we looked, we saw about the same ratio of hydrogen to helium, about 75%, 25%. One of them, you can subtract one from one of them, but roughly, if we ignore the 1% that's other stuff, 75%, 25%, right? But why would it be the same everywhere, right? This region over here evolves very differently from some region way over there. Why should the ratio be about the same? Another question is, why did neutrons exist? If you look at, if you take a neutron out of the nucleus of an atom, a neutron has a half-life of 15 minutes. So within 15 minutes, you know, roughly you can expect that neutron to no longer exist. It'll decay into a proton, electron, and an electron antineutrino, right? But yet neutrons do exist. So what this means is that either there must be some new way of producing neutrons, right? Or all of the neutrons got locked into the cores of atoms very early in the history of the universe, right? So Gamow sought to understand these problems, okay? And what he came up with was a scenario that actually generated what we observe. So one question is, how do we get the ratio of hydrogen to helium? So nuclear physics had just been discovered, right? The neutron had just been discovered also. And people knew that inside of stars, hydrogen gets cooked into helium. And so Gamow said, well, if the universe is expanding today, that means that in the past it was smaller. Right? And so if it was smaller, if I take a gas and I compress it and I don't allow energy to come into or out of the system, the so-called adiabatic process, then what would happen is that the gas would heat up. Right? So if the universe was smaller in the past, it would have been hotter in the past. Okay? And so if it was hotter in the past, if you get it small enough, you can make it as hot as the core of a star. And if you do, you can now cook hydrogen into helium. But then the obvious question becomes, well then why wasn't all of the hydrogen cooked into helium? Why is it 75%, 25% roughly, right? And so what Gamow did, his team, they found a solution to this. That is, if you add light to the mix, light, photons, then the light can act sort of as a buffer to slow down the reaction. And so he came out with a magic number that if you have about 1 billion particles of light for every proton in the universe, then you would get this ratio that we observe. Right? If you add more light, you get less helium. If you add less light, you get more helium. Right? So in order to get what we observe, you have to have this 1 billion to 1. Right? Now that is a prediction of the model that we can now go and look at to see whether or not the model is correct. Right? So now, of course, Gamow's colleagues, they're going to play the role of Poisson. Well, Gamow, your theory predicts something ridiculous. I don't see this light. Let's go look for it. Right? So Gamow made his prediction, and guess what his colleague said? They didn't say anything, they ignored it. Yeah. And what happens is, in the 60s, Dickey and Peebles and a group at Princeton, they redid the calculation, completely unaware of Gamow's calculation, coming up with the exact same answer, okay? And so they predicted that this light should exist. And their colleague, Roll and Wilkinson, began building a system to detect this light, this radiation. And so while they are getting ready to make the measurement of the light, two Bell Labs engineers actually measure it and discover it, Penzias and Wilson, for which they ultimately won the Nobel Prize, right? And so the question is, what should the light look like? So if you look at this circle right here, this circle represents the measurement of Penzias and Wilson. And it's superimposed on a black body. Why a black body? Because in this hot state, when the universe would have been so hot that you could cook up elements, it would have been a plasma, and it would have been an opaque plasma. So the universe would have been opaque everywhere. So the light that would have existed in the universe would have had a black body spectrum. And so what happened is that other people decided, okay, let's go and measure to see if it has that black body spectrum that you're Big Bang model predicts. And so these are some of the measurements that people made, different teams made. And eventually, they began to deviate from this black body curve. And so people began to speculate that, oh, well, maybe it's something else. But then in the 80s, a satellite went up called COBE, the Cosmic Background Explorer satellite, and it measured the actual spectrum of the microwave background, a very high precision. How high was the precision? The squares on this curve here are the data points. The size of the square represents the error in the measurement. Okay? So the sizes of the squares have been blown up 400 times, just for you to see. Do you remember that black body curve that I showed of the sun? It didn't fit the black body too well, did it? I mean, it fit really well, but it was off a little bit, right? Yes, look how well the black body spectrum of the universe matches a black body curve, right? It is actually the most precise black body we've ever measured. So the physicists at this point, okay, it happened. The universe was once hot and small, right? But you can think of a scenario that can fool you. You could think of another way to get this black body curve, which is not having everywhere in the universe be an opaque plasma. What is the other way? Well, what if there is an opaque surface out there somewhere that is emitting this light? Based on the flux of the light, you can calculate where that surface must be. It turns out that it has to be about 200,000 light years away from us. Our galaxy is 100,000 light years in size. So that means that there would be a shell, an opaque shell surrounding our galaxy, and we would not be able to see more distant galaxies, right? But we do. So obviously, that's not what's happening here. So the only proper interpretation is that everywhere in the universe, it was an opaque plasma, right? So that's what we know. And I tell you, this plot here just blows me away, all right? So if you take a detector, and you point it at anywhere in space, and you look at the wavelength of light that you receive from everywhere in space, what you find is a function, so this is higher energy light on this end, this is lower energy light, you know, gamma rays down here, radio waves up there. It looks like a very nice decaying power law on this plot, and then superimposed on this thing is a black body spectrum, right? That is like utterly amazing to me. And the other thing that you see is that most of the energy density of the light in the universe is in this black body spectrum. So the fact that the universe is filled with this light, it's microwave, so we can't see it, right? But it's there and it dominates the light of the universe, right? And it's, I don't know about you, are you as struck by that as I am? Okay, that means you're not as big a nerd as me, but, you know, keep watching the Big Bang Theory, you'll get there. So of course people ask, okay, what else can we predict about this model? So someone thought about what would have happened in this early universe, and so we come to understand that there's this stuff called dark matter. So in this very early state of the universe, when it was this primordial plasma, this dark matter would have clumped gravitationally on different scales. You'd have some small dark matter lumps, you'd have some large dark matter lumps, and what happens is that the normal matter, what we call baryonic matter, it would be attracted gravitationally to the dark matter, just like it is today. And it would have fallen into these dark matter concentrations. And what would have happened is that as the matter falls in, it's ionized. And free charged particles interact very strongly with light. That's why, for example, metals look shiny when you look at them, right? They have free electrons that scatter light of all wavelengths. And so as the matter falls in, then the photons interact very strongly with the matter, and it generates a pressure. And this pressure acts like a spring. And so as the matter falls in, the photon pressure will ultimately push it back out, right? So what happens is that this leaves a signature on the light, right? So what happens is that these regions will oscillate. And the signature on the light, what happens is that the matter falls in, interacts with the photons, gets pushed back out. When it gets pushed in, the photons get blue shifted. When it gets pushed back out, the photons get red shifted. So we now predict that in this cosmic microwave background radiation, we should have these different regions with these different patterns of red shifts and blue shifts, and they should correlate with different density concentrations of matter in the universe. And so here is the largest lumps that would have just fallen in before the universe went from being an opaque plasma to being a dilute gas. And then this is the next size lumps where they got bounced out. Then you go to smaller lumps, so it's like compactification, rarefication. And this is all old data, so the error bars are incredibly huge. But in 2003, a new satellite called the WMAP satellite, remember Wilkinson, who worked with the Princeton group who was making the instrument? It was named after him, the Wilkinson Microwave Anisotropy Probe. And there is the map of these red shifts and blue shifts all across the sky in the cosmic microwave background radiation, right? The discoverers of these anisotropies, Mather and Smoot, they won a Nobel Prize in 2006 in physics for being the first to discover these anisotropies. But these These are what grew into the galaxies that exist today. And one of the major efforts in astronomy right now is what are called baryon acoustic oscillations, right? So this is how the pattern of the distribution of galaxies matches up with the pattern of the distribution of the density distribution that we see in the light. But you can do an analysis of these anisotropies, and you can predict how many there should be of various sizes, what we call multipole moments. And so if you look at smaller sizes over here, larger sizes this way, the black dots are measurements from the WMAP data, and the red line is a prediction from the Big Bang model. So again, we make a prediction of something that no one's ever heard. Have you guys ever heard of acoustic oscillations? In another, you have, not in the cosmology case, but in some other case. Really, what? Not those. I'm talking about light and yeah. We've all heard of those acoustic oscillations. Yeah. And then there's another prediction, and that is that when light bounces off of something, it typically polarizes, right? And so one down to earth example of that is when you watch a TV show where they fish, right? The fishing shows. You guys watch that? They catch a big beautiful fish and they throw them back. Mm-hmm. It's crazy. But anyway, what happens is they always have these commercials where they advertise these sunglasses that allow you to look into the water and see the fish, right? And what happens is that when you look at the surface of the water, there's two sources of light that you're seeing. There's a light that bounces off the surface and comes to your eye, and there's a light that originates from under the water and comes to your eye, right? And there are different strengths. Another example of that is, you ever notice in the daytime, you look out your window really easily, but it's hard to look in a window? Mm-hmm. Not that I go around looking at windows. And in the nighttime, it's the exact opposite, right? Look in the house through the window, but it's hard to look out the house, right? That's because at the window, you're going to have light that's going in both directions, right? So there's light on the inside, and it's going to strike the window. Some of it's going to pass through, some of it's going to reflect. There's light from the outside, some of it's going to pass through, some of it's going to reflect. At night, there's very little coming in. So all I see when I look at the window is the reflected component from the inside light that's stronger. When it's daytime, the light coming from the outside is much stronger than the reflected component, so I see the outside light. And it's the exact same thing with these polarization sunglasses. You put them on, they block the polarized light, and you see the fish from under the water, the light that originates from under the water. Well, as it turns out, that the last thing this light would have done, this cosmic microwave background light would have done before the universe turned into a hydrogen gas, is it would have bounced off a proton or an electron, right? Which means it would have been polarized. And again, in 2003, John Carlson with the South Pole Telescope made the very first measurement of the polarization of the cosmic microwave background radiation. The red line is the prediction. The red bars here are the measurement. Big giant error bars, but yet it's consistent, right? Especially in regions like here, right? The data is consistent, so it's not inconsistent. It's easy to prove something, to disprove something. It's hard to prove, but it's easy to disprove things. So here we go. So when it comes to this cosmic microwave background radiation, there's all sorts of predictions. Only thing that we started with is there are neutrons. We have a ratio of hydrogen to helium. The universe is expanding. And then you make all these predictions. There should be this light to get this ratio that we see. It should have a particular, there should be a particular amount of it in the universe. A lot, right? It should have a black body spectrum at a particular temperature. It should have these anisotropies that we observe. There should be this acoustic oscillation signal. There should be this polarization signal. All these things are predictions that were then observed to be true. Right? So it's just like the example of Poisson's spot. Now, this also gives us something else, the cosmic microwave background radiation. We can predict how big these anisotropies should appear. Right? The largest ones should be about 1 degree. And so if the universe has any curvature, that would have the effect of distorting the shapes and sizes of these anisotropies. And so if they are the size that we predict, then the universe has no curvature. If they are much smaller, then the universe has negative curvature. And if they're much bigger, the universe has positive curvature, right? And as it turns out, we measured that the universe had no curvature, right? So here is what we call the omega m omega lambda plane. So on here, in the meantime, we discovered dark energy. All right, so here we put the density of stuff that has positive gravity, attractive gravity. Here we put the density of stuff that has negative gravity, repulsive gravity, okay? And so by measuring the size of the universe versus time, by using type 1a supernovae, one is able to put a constraint on the amount of negative gravity stuff and positive gravity stuff there is. And it's an ellipse that looks something like that. By measuring how much matter there is in these galaxy clusters that I showed you that we've mapped out, right? You can put a constraint on how much mass there is in the universe, right? And you get something like that. And the cosmic microwave background radiation, if the universe is flat, it turns out that the value of this quantity, what I call omega m, and this quantity, omega lambda, they sum to 1. So when this one is 0, that one is 1. When this one is 0, that one is 1. So forth, right? So that's a constraint that goes along like this. Now, this is what we call the new era of precision cosmology. And so before this, everyone thought there was no dark energy. Everyone thought that we had a flat universe and there was no dark energy. But what we see very clearly is that all of these three different probes, they have nothing to do with each other, right? What does measuring the size of the universe as a function of time using supernovae have to do with the cosmic microwave background radiation? Nothing. What does that have to do with measuring how much mass there is in the volume of space? Nothing. They have nothing to do with each other, and yet they all overlap at the same point here, right? And so this has created what we call our concordance model of cosmology. So when we talk about what exists, now we've come to discover that 95% of what exists is stuff that we don't even know what it is, right? Dark matter and dark energy. And to make matters worse, the 4.4% of stuff that is stuff like us, baryonic matter, we've only really discovered the 0.4%, right? The galaxies. The 4 is believed to be, and when I say believed to be, suspected to be any intergalactic medium, right? Very diffusely distributed in the space between the galaxies. And now you can see that the spectrum of the cosmic microwave background radiation also is very sensitive to both the amount of dark energy, that's the blue curve, and the shape of the universe, right? So as we adjust these things, when I showed you the data versus the theory, you see that these things are very sensitive to each other. So it could have been very different, but yet everything matched up really nice. So the final thing is the Big Bang also has a prediction for what elements should exist in the universe, right? That's what Gamow did. He did this calculation. So very light elements are produced in the universe, and ions, not ions, isotopes. And what you can do is that you can draw these curves. So deuterium, for example, is very sensitive to the density in the early universe, which translates to the density of the universe today, right? So what we can do is we can look at the prediction, we can look at the measurement of the relative abundances of these elements in the universe today, and we can compare that to the present density of the universe. This line could be anywhere up here, right? It could be anywhere, right? This is the measurement of what it is. This is the measurement of what it could be anywhere. And what you see is that for all these elements, it's all consistent, right? The same model gives you the fact that the observed abundance and the observed present density of nucleons in the universe is consistent across all these species is another very solid piece of evidence that shows us that the model is very strong. So now we have this picture of the universe, right? And I guess this is a couple of slides too early. This is what happens when you make a slide 10 minutes before you talk. Now, this all is fine and well. Right? And so it tells us very strongly something. And what is that? Is that the universe was much smaller and much hotter in the past. Okay? It had a much higher density. So that is on extremely strong footing. All right? But what are some things that are left unexplained? Well, we want to know how something came out of nothing. We know how to create matter out of the vacuum of space-time. Right? The laws of quantum mechanics predicts that all around us right now, the vacuum should be seething with particle-antiparticle pairs. Right? But the point is that they always show up in particle-antiparticle pairs. The universe that we live in has very little antimatter. It's all matter. right? Unless you're in the engine room of the Starship Enterprise where they have a matter-antimatter conversion chamber, right? But why is that, right? The laws of the universe are symmetric in matter and antimatter, yet we live in a matter universe. The flatness problem. Remember when I told you the example of I put the fog on the universe and, you know, there's all these different densities that the matter could have. And there's only one, there's an infinity of them, right? And there's only one that yields a flat universe. Why is that the one that we observe to be actually the one that the universe, the state the universe is in? That's very odd also. Then there's the so-called horizon problem, which is, what's the horizon problem again? If I look, what's the horizon problem again? Yeah, why is it so uniform? That's it, yeah. So if I look at, as far as I can in this direction, right, I look at the temperature, I look at the temperature of the cosmic microwave background radiation, I look as far as I can in this direction, this light has been traveling to me since the time of decoupling, right, billions of years, and yet they are the same temperature to within 10 to the minus 5 degrees Kelvin. Why is that? They've been out of contact forever. Why are they at roughly the same temperature? And finally, there are the so-called relic particles. If you look at the details of the Big Bang theory, it predicts certain particles that should never, that have never been seen. For example, so-called magnetic monopoles, right? If you look at electric charges, you can have a single positive electric charge. But magnetic charges always come in positive and negative together, right? If you take a bar magnet and you slice it in half, you don't get a positive half and a negative half, right? You get a positive negative and a positive negative. Right? But these models predict that there should be these relic particles that exist. So what do we do? Well, we have even more problems. Why is the universe expanding anyway? Why is there stuff in the universe? Why is there matter anyway? Okay? How do we explain these things? Well, it turns out that there is one idea that can solve all those problems. Okay? And that is the so-called inflationary model. So if the universe was very small in the past and then rapidly inflated, areas that are very far away today would have been in very close contact initially. So imagine if, you know, you take the region between my fingers here and you suddenly expand it to you know, 150 million light years across. Right? Then what happens? Right? That area is all about the same. So in the universe, in inflation, the universe, depending upon which inflation model you look at, it would have expanded in size by a factor of 10 to the 25th or to 10 to the 50th and something like 10 to the minus 34th of a second along that time scale. Right? So very rapidly, the universe would have expanded itself. I'm sorry. That's my alarm. It's going to keep doing that unless I turn it off. I turn into a werewolf 1 hour after that goes off, so I have to. I don't want to eat you guys, so you better. Then there's the antimatter problem, right? Why do we live in a matter-dominated universe at all? Well, this is kind of complex, right? So the idea of how you come with a matter-antimatter asymmetry was first put forward by a Russian scientist named Andrei Sakharov, right? And if you look at processes involving elementary particles, you know, our students take elementary particles here as a course, there are these two numbers that are always conserved in reactions. One is the baryon number. This has to do with nuclear particles, right? Things change, but the baryon number always stays the same. You always have the same number of things like quarks, right? And then there's the lepton number. These things all also remain the same, right? You can go from one sort to another, but the lepton number is always conserved. Well, one requirement for having an asymmetry in matter and antimatter is that baryon number and lepton number are not conserved, right? And so what happened is that the particle physicists conceived of these things called supersymmetric particles. So in the very early universe, when the temperatures were high enough, you could have a situation where what we call bosons today, things that have a spin of one, the force carriers, photons, the gluons that hold quarks together, the gauge bosons that are involved with the decay of the neutron, these things could convert into what we call fermions today. What are fermions? Fermions are the matter particles, like the electron, the neutrinos, the quarks, okay? Today, that does not happen. Bosons do not decay into quarks and leptons, and quarks and leptons do not decay into bosons. But it's predicted that in this early universe, that's what would have happened. You would have had quarks and anti-quarks, leptons and anti-leptons, and you would have had bosons and anti-bosons. And so for every lepton, for every matter particle, you would have a bosonic partner that's called the supersymmetric partner. So instead of quarks, you would have squarks. Instead of leptons, you would have sleptons. Okay? These things are predicted. Okay? Now, do they exist? And so what would have happened is that as you had these processes going back and forth, right? Quark, the bosons becoming the fermions, going back and forth at high temperatures, both reactions will work in the same direction equally. But as the universe expands, it cools, okay? And so what would happen is that some reactions would get favored over others. So no matter what the temperature is, matter-antimatter particles will annihilate each other. Right? And so what ends up happening is that after a certain time, if the decay from antiparticles into particles is favored over the decay of particles into antiparticles, then you could end up with a particle-antiparticle asymmetry. So if what you end up with, remember, where do photons come from? Matter. So how do we end up with this 10 to the 9 photons for every matter particle? For every proton, right? Somehow you need some matter to create these photons. So the idea is that if you had this slight asymmetry in these decay rates, the so-called CP violation, then what would happen is that if you ended up with a situation where you had a billion plus one matter particles for every billion antimatter particles, then the billion matter would annihilate the billion antimatter, and you'd be left with one matter particle and a billion photons. Does that make sense? Yes. Okay. Now, does this process occur? Does this violation occur where one type of decay is favored over another type of decay? Well, we've seen it twice. There's a particle called the K meson that has this sort of asymmetry, and then Slack built the mesons are quark anti-quark pairs, whereas things like the neutron and the proton are made up of three quarks. So Slack built an instrument called B bar, which is the B particle and the anti-B meson, also to look for these sort of asymmetries and decays, and they saw evidence of this, right? And they call it Babar after the elephant, right? Their experiment. But it's been seen, right? So the point is that you create this scenario, and then you make a prediction. What is required? You have to have this so-called CP violation for this to occur, and in fact, that has been seen. All right. However, the LHC is running a new experiment, and guess what happened? Oh, it says LHC experiment finds no signs of supersymmetry, right? I don't know why this is not getting a lot more press. This just came out August 30th. But the lightest of these supersymmetric particles is the main candidate for dark matter, right? So this is the first big chink in the armor of this idea that we have about inflation, right? We're just getting to the point now where we can test it. And so far, LHC is not seeing it where it should, right? So this lightest symmetric partner has an energy of about 1 TeV. And that's exactly where we expect that thing to be. So what about these relic particles? Well, if the universe expanded so large, the idea is you would have diluted them such that you don't see them. So what would have caused this inflation, right? So as the universe ages, it goes through several transitions, right? The forces at higher energies, they unite, right? And there are fields that govern these particular transitions known as Higgs fields. So there's the electroweak transition beyond which the electric field and the weak force and the electric force appear identical. Then there's the Guts transition where the strong force combines. And then there's the inflationary Higgs particle, the particle that would have accounted for this rapid expansion. When this Higgs field decay, that's what would have driven the inflation. Now, does the Higgs field exist? Do these Higgs particles exist? Well, you may know that the LHC, the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, one of the main things it's doing is it's looking for these Higgs particles, right? The other thing that's happening is that if you look at the cosmic microwave background radiation, If you look at the cosmic microwave background radiation, maybe I should have done it the other way. Because if I press it one time too many, we're going to be back at the beginning. Oh, boy. What's that?
Is that the slideshow or the universe, and we're back at the beginning?
See, I was more clever than I realized. So right here, if you look at this, so the polarization of the cosmic microwave background radiation has two modes. One is the so-called divergenceless mode, the cross mode of the polarization, and the other is the curlless mode, the EE mode. The EE mode has been observed. So the people that study the cosmic microwave background radiation, there's two big experiments. One is called the ACT experiment. It's run out of Princeton in the Atacama Desert in Chile, and the other is a South Pole Telescope. They're both building instruments to measure the cross mode of the polarization. This mode, if it exists, will also confirm the existence of inflation, that inflation did in fact happen. So we have this very detailed picture of the universe, right, where we have a timeline. All of the action happens right in the earliest times, right? So the nuclear era, from here forward, has all been verified, right, thus far. And back there is where the uncertainty lies, right? And so one chink in the armor, like we said, is the supersymmetric particles. We don't see those. We're looking for the BB polarization mode, the CMB, to see whether inflation happened. We're looking for the Higgs particle at CERN, and people are still looking for CP violation at SLAC. So that's it, everyone. I hope you learned something about the creation.